Hi, this is Don Gooding from Greenlight Maine. Some of the best conversations among entrepreneurs and mentors happen when we're not recording for the Saturday night show. We thought you'd like to see them.
I was just curious, where are you manufacturing these?
Yeah, so in Maine right now. We have for 10 years I've had an engineering business, and I have a close relationship with my manufacturing partner because of that. So I'm moving into this business now. It's in the Bangor area.
Yeah, again, to the point I tried to make earlier, I think there's opportunities to get exposure that's relatively inexpensive for you. I think of a family member of mine who's recovering from ACL surgery, who's in his 60s, who a vehicle like this, so he doesn't have to use a walker to get around, would be a perfect vehicle for him.
So I'm going to build on that, because there seems to be this gap between our own perception of how attractive this is and kind of the reality. So I'm wondering whether you could build on what you're actually finding with people, the resistance points are.
Yep.
Is it price, or is it features, or what do you think those resistance points are on the sales side?
Yeah, so on the with the individuals that are very excited and motivated and hear about us, there's virtually no resistance. You know, they come to us, they want a product, you know, yesterday in July. Since then, obviously now we're in a great position to serve those people. With the individuals that take some literature from our website to their physical therapist and say, hey, is this a good product for me? It's mixed. You know, some physical therapists want to know more about the types of benefits we've studied, and then others are, you know, kind of see the benefits. So in order to really, ideally we get every physical therapist in the U.S. educated about this product, and they all think it's great and they understand the benefits, right? So that's ideal. Right now we don't have any real clinical results to back up any of the claims we make about the benefits of our product. We have a physical therapist on our team. We have a clinical program in place. It's just, you know, years out.
Go ahead.
What if you were to that problem? What if you were to go to an organization who had the funding, who could buy two or three of them, and you could negotiate with them to start to build your clinical data, mm-hmm. so that, you know, an injured worker could ask for that kind of a device in order to become more mobile and get back to their normal lifestyle.
Yep.
But a big organization who could buy two or three of them and basically put them into the market, and then you could get your feedback. And if it were associated with occupational health nurses, physicians, a rehab hospital, any of those things, you'll get the credibility as well.
Yep.
For your data.
Yep.
So what about people tend to move on based on influence. If you could get some key endorsements, to me, this is just marketing stuff and not really the question you asked, because your initial question was about how do you balance how you're being pulled in two directions. We seem to talk a lot about marketing as if that will accomplish and somehow create a win between that balance. It won't. It'll pull you harder in one direction.
Mm-hmm.
But you could get endorsements. But again, what's the pull that you're talking about that you feel from the R&D? What's going on there?
It's more just with the product that we have now. I've personally been a part of that R&D team that mm-hmm. took it from the fourth generation prototype to now the seventh generation prototype. And there's some expectation that there needs to be continuity, you know, in the development cycle from our R&D team. Mm-hmm. And you know, I see the rationale in that. I personally, you know, if there's somebody that can supplant my role on that team, and it could be somebody that's part of our advisory team right now. We're trying to work, you know, all of the various clinical options for that whole program. So that's an option, but that it's just forming that team is kind of the option. I've sort of been one of the legs of the stool, you know, to keep it going.
Do you have a formal or informal mechanism to take the feedback that you're hearing from the field and getting it back to your R&D team, or is that solely coming through you?
I guess it is just coming through me, yeah.
And, yep. And two other questions. What's the price point for the vehicle?
Yeah, so we are on target from the pitch. You know, we have two offerings, a $1,450 unit that's a standard unit, and then a fat tire unit that it seems popular in adaptive sports, that's $1,850.
Okay.
And good for beach and all-terrain weather.
And I apologize for being candid, but have you ever sold?
We have. Have I ever sold? Yeah. No. Okay. Well, engineering services, but it's a completely different. I recognize that, and I recognize that going into this. And I would say, you know, in the 3 or 4 weeks that, you know, we've been going through a very formal sales process. Of course, we have a CRM in place. We have a motivational tool in place with one of my advisors, who's has 15 years as a senior sales executive. He's treating me like a junior salesman. So, you know, it's actually a very formal process in place, and we're going through evals, and I'm actually meeting my goals.
Just my first reaction to the price was that the market is probably better from a rental perspective, from a bike shop or from a rehab facility, than folks being able to go out and buy it, because I would doubt it that insurance companies will cover it, or maybe you've already investigated that. That'll be a huge bogey for you to deal with.
That's the truth, yes. And that's part of our clinical program, is also to figure out a mechanism for future insurance reimbursement. And that's why, you know, we see the individuals that are interested and they come, but there really is an effort to reach out to businesses that can offer this as a part in a shared use setting. For example, your resident communities, exactly what you mentioned, outdoor sports facilities and recreation. And then there's some opportunities in rehab clinics, you know, right now with the therapists that are actually excited about the product for very specific populations, and MS is one of them. It's just when you get into joint replacement, it gets a little bit different. Sports rehab, there might be some opportunity as well, but we're still a little far away with that one.
A walker costs $69.
Yes, it does.
So that's your...
Yeah, it does.
I have seen in our organization where vendors come in with new products, and when we have our loss control consultants, our safety people, our health nurses, when they're all in the room and there are numerous people, then they come and do a demo. Mm-hmm. And then we have on occasion, I wouldn't say every time, but on occasion, taken those products, put them out and had them utilized by an injured worker or a physical therapy office or a physician office practice. Mm. So sometimes getting in front of those bigger groups, you've just increased your sales force, because now all of those people have your information.
Yeah.
That's why I said, muscular sclerosis, people are losing their mobility. They need the stability. Mm-hmm. They want to be out. I could see somebody on the... in Acadia with that thing, with the knobby tire. And really, it would be great promotion there as well if you had a big group there and you were there.
There's all kinds of demo, like group stuff you could do.
But you need
that.
Their endorsement.
Yeah.
I want to come back to the, I've got this problem right now. What do I do right now? Because one of the things we haven't talked about is cash. Uh-huh. And I know you've been bootstrapping this all along.
Yep.
And it seems like to me that if you can, you found that there's some segment of the market that really wants to rip this out of your hands, and they want to pay the full price because they are dying to have it. Is that a fair?
It's fair to say, as long as we get the word out there to those people in a certain way. Yeah.
So it seems to me like, since you're at that launch and you're going to make more cash if you have a direct sale to the people who are absolutely dying to have it, because you don't have to pay the marketing costs, it seems like in the very short term, the next 3 months, that ought to be your focus, because you're at that, I've got to launch the product. It's a brand new product. It's not like you've got competitive pressures, like there's 5 other companies that are bringing similar products on the market, and you need cash, and you need validation, and you need feedback from real customers, and you've gotten the initial response that people are, a few, you know, out of all of the 20 segments that you could possibly go in, there's this very few that will pay full price and they want it now. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that would be a great focus for right now, and you can continue at a slower pace with the discussions with the folks that are going to take a much longer time. Because mm-hmm. all of these other things, you know, it might be a 6-month sales cycle, it might be a 5-year sales cycle, and you want a, you know, a 1-week sales cycle.
I
would do two things to build on what has been said. On the rehab market, I'd find a couple of big physical therapy houses in Maine, and I'd give them the units, and I'd have them use them with their patients for 3-6 months, and all you're asking for is feedback about the reaction that they get. I think that's a worthwhile investment. The other thing I'd do on the recreation market is I'd burn a DVD that shows the product. I know I keep talking about AARP, but it's the most single read magazine in the country by people over 50. I'd run a little ad in the back with all those other ads, and I suspect you would get a tremendous amount of at least response for the DVD. Then you got to figure out how to ship it to Iowa, but make sure you know what that, how you're going to do that before you do it. I think those two things could be very, very helpful to you.
Mm-hmm. How's your social media traction doing these days?
It's good. I mean, we, every time, you know, like this, for example, this filming, you know, was a huge fall, you know, everybody found us because of it, you know, and that was our first, and in July, that was the first time we were going out trying to build awareness about it. We have a good following. It can always be better.
Of course.
And I think it's really a local following right now, so we haven't taken it to that next step. But
right now, that's actually what you need, because you're not quite ready to ship the bike, right?
Yeah, so there's a practical hurdle of taking that unit, boxing it, doing assembly instructions, you know, for the person that receives it on the other end. We haven't crossed that bridge yet, you know, and that's one of the priorities that I kind of just put to the back, because there's some effort involved, and again on my part to make that happen.
Ryan, who have you asked that could endorse this product? Like, can I use people's names? Like Betty White, walking down the beach with that thing, you're gonna get sales. Who have you asked to help you that you don't think will?
Major influencers, we have some testimonials right now.
No, I mean, who have you asked that you don't, that would be too big for you to ask, that's too, where have you stretched to get help? Because someone will help you with this.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, we haven't, yep.
So how would he go about doing that, do you think?
You know, there are some things you can do over a beer, and you can just sit back and sort of write down some people, you know, if so-and-so would help, imagine if so-and-so. And it's really worth taking the time to kind of dream a little about who would be your dream person to help you.
Yeah.
It's not as much of a shot in the dark as it sounds like. You still have to do all the logistical things to back that up, because growth can take off.
I've got two people in mind that I've seen.
There you go.
You know, one of them was actually Barbara Bush. She was using this beach walker.
There you go.
And, you know, and then the other
She's
would be,
Maine.
You know, some way to, in the beach to beacon, you know, like imagine some people in a running event, you know, like you know, Joe Benoit. That,
those are both great ideas. Mm-hmm. So maybe there are people out there who can help you connect with both of those. So the timing of those, when are you going to be ready to really be ramping up?
Yeah, well, as soon as we get, if we got 20 today, we can build them and deliver in 4 weeks.
Great to know. So you're not
deliver in Maine.
In Maine, yeah. The national picture yet. We're not ready to handle that. So right now we say you can pick up from our site, or I can deliver it to you, or somebody on our team can deliver it to you.
Okay. Does that spur any additional thoughts on? What, because I'm really focused on, I mean, you've got this challenge right now.
Yeah.
It's been just you. You're trying to find balance and engineering the balance.
Yeah.
I love that idea. In fact, I want to build on that just a little bit. Are there any, I'm not an engineer, so are there any engineering techniques that you use to achieve balance in a physical product context?
Well, I've kind of had to unengineer the whole thing. I guess as an engineer, if I'm successful 3% of the time, it's complete failure, right? So, but on the other hand, if in sales you're successful 3% of the time, I mean, some people say that's great. I mean, just like balancing those metrics, you know, how, as an engineer, you know, how do I accept the fact that, you know, I'm going to go out there, cold call, talk to a lot of people, and, you know, I'm not going to get the overwhelming response I might have expected. As an engineer, I can't fail even 0.5% of the time.
It'll take you the minimum of 5 sales calls before you even get a sale, generally. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's higher. Mm.
So how many sales calls a week are you doing?
We're doing about 3 to 4 demos a week, and, you know, cold emailing 20 to 30. And, you know, so we have that kind of rate coming into our pipeline right now.
I was actually thinking of 5 calls to the same person before you get a sale.
Yeah. So, you know, with the non-responses, how do you deal with the non-responses? Yeah, we...
Well, you don't learn anything until you get a no. Once you get a no, you can work.
Yep.
Exactly. Yeah, you learn a lot from the no's. What are all those objections out there?
Yeah. All feedback.
Yep. Yeah. Yep.
Excellent.
Wild ride. Yeah, it's, for me, it's been the last 3 years, almost 4 now. And yeah, you probably saw the product at the university. And
Carol Kim had a tour of a variety of entrepreneurial things going on, and saw your product back then. So.
So 2 of our team are the 2 original inventors of the product. They're professors there.
Husband and wife?
Husband and wife,
as I recall.
Liz and Steven. And they, you know, it was out of their needs, their personal needs, you know, and they're very active. She wanted to get outside the house and not run on a treadmill. And that's where it started.
Again, I think for someone who's going to use this for a really long time, the price point is probably okay. You need to test that. But for the rehab market, particularly in the uninsured rehab market, at least currently, you need to get into a rental mode with pharmacies who sell rehab equipment, because again, I don't mean to kick a dead horse, but that $69 walker measured against the $1,450, I think that's a non-starter. But if you could figure out a rental agreement, or the pharmacy could or whoever could figure out a rental agreement, I think you can move the product.
I think that's too. But I sat on the board for the Muscular Sclerosis Society.
Okay.
And we have had at that time development money, and we would purchase assistive devices for people. Mm-hmm. So that would be a way to sell your product, put it into the market, and then when it's no longer utilized, they would take it back and reissue it to another person. And, you know, for that kind of a device to be in the marketplace, you could do it in Maine, but you'll get national exposure because the organization to post it in the Momentum magazine, which is national, and that is going to really spur a lot of conversation around what it is, how it can be utilized, and why it's so good for their organization. Mm-hmm. And it's not costing the individual any money because the organization is putting it in the marketplace. Then you'll have those people who are in a position to buy that because it's helpful to them. Yep. So you have an opportunity to capitalize on what's happening here and spread it nationally. But you do have to get back to engineering and shipping.
Yeah.
So there's product innovation, and then there's delivery or process innovation. One of the big coffee chains, Starbucks, didn't innovate their product. They innovated the delivery system, the way you buy coffee, what it feels like to do it. The company that made that little thing you drive around and ride around, they said, you can have one and it won't cost you anything, right? So thinking in terms of, and again, engineering, but being creative on your delivery system and on the how that could look differently.
Mm. Yeah.
Just the random thought of which I'm always accused, but I was in New York City 5 weeks ago and watched the New York Marathon. To see a couple of your pieces of equipment in that marathon would be cool. Unbelievable.
That would be.
And an audience.
Yeah. We've been thinking about those exact types of events and which ones could be great for us. And you know, that the MS Society has the walks, you know, all over. And so I actually reached out to somebody in Falmouth here about it. And I'd like to find the right connection in Maine, you know, maybe to start, and then how it would go from there with MS particular.
I'm wondering if a GoFundMe kind of campaign with the beneficiary being one of these organizations for the purpose of riding the bikes. I mean, that gets to the creative delivery. Mm. If you're putting all these pieces together, that might be a way to help really get the visibility for the product, show that it's supporting a good cause,
It's a win for everybody.
It's a win for everybody.
Well, it also causes you to really refine your message, your delivery. Mm-hmm. A product is just a product. Why you're using it drives you to spend money. Mm-hmm. So your message on a GoFundMe video has to be about how this will improve your life. I'll pay $100 for a walker, but I'll pay $1,800 to be able to feel like I'm a real person and like I can live. Mm-hmm. There's a difference, right?
Yeah, certainly. And we're certainly not trying to compete with, you know, the walkers in the...
It's a new category.
No,
really.
Yeah, exactly.
This is for a different audience.
It is, yeah, and it's outdoors. The outdoors is a big part of it, and being upright is a big part of it. And, you know, we've solved those two challenges there's people in that space, you know, other devices are kind of in that space, but they're not addressing both of those simultaneously, and that's where... You know, our two co-founders said there's a real need here, you know, our personal need, but there's all kinds of people out there that can benefit from this.
People are more physically fit too when they're upright and moving.
Yeah.
So there's, you know, there's a wellness component to this.
There is, yep. And we have a testimonial from a chiropractor. Says the posture benefit. You know, I didn't think this patient would be able to stand up this upright again, and they look, they're walking with it. So there's all kinds of, you know, benefits across a lot of different areas.
The family member I alluded to, guy 65, 66 years old, he's 6'4", he's 240, tears up his knee, scared to death to walk because he didn't have a support mechanism and the walker just was too flimsy for him, took him forever.
Yep.
That piece of equipment would have been great for him.
Yeah.
You know, what's interesting, the folks were telling me just now that the interview that you had for the last time you were on Greenlight Maine had 2,000 views and was shared 300 times, which is rather astonishing. I think it shows the potential, and I think it also shows the potential of video for you. That, you know, I'm sure seeing real people using the real device is going to have that kind of virality that's gonna help a lot.
That was explosive for us. I mean, that day was crazy. I mean, I was watching, it was morning coffee and I was watching it and, you know, it was like 18 views and it went up to 300 views and then soon we were at 1,000 views. I'm like, what is going on? It's all within the period of a couple hours.
Just the way you drew it up.
Yeah.
well, that's...
And that was the interview. That wasn't really even the product. That was just the interview.
So I think that being, you know, oh my gosh, we had this with video. Seems like, do you have any new video creation on your calendar?
We just created a bunch of new content and it's being rolled out, in the next couple weeks. Yeah, as a result of selling the product and, you know, we need these tools to be able to sell. So that's where, you know, video comes in so handy. We have a, you know, minute and a half piece, we have a 15 second piece, have a series of 1 minute short Q&A with me. So we have, you know, content for a few months.
So when you do that, definitely let me and the rest of us in the Greenlight Maine community know, because we actually have a pretty big reach now doing a bunch of these shows. Yeah. I think sharing those videos among all of us, I think we'll be able to help with that virality.
Well, yeah.
Excellent.
I appreciate it.
There are lots more unstructured conversations like this on the Greenlight Maine YouTube channel, which you can find on greenlightmaine.com by clicking behind the scenes, or maybe you've already done that. So enjoy the exploration.